I want to begin by welcoming all of you from so many different faculties and schools and departments here into the Deshotel Faculty of Management. My name is Steve McGuire, and I have the honor of being the director of the Marcel Deshotel Institute for Integrated Management. And the mission of our institute is to advance an integrated view of management, one that takes a holistic perspective and embraces multiple perspectives on what it is to organize and to be a business. You can think of us as our faculty's articulation of interdisciplinarity. And one of our roles is to break down the silos that sometimes, unfortunately, separate our faculty from other faculties. And that's why I'm so excited about this event, focused on two of our key thematic priorities, which are sustainability and innovation. Two concepts, phenomena, that really don't sit easily in one single faculty. So welcome to the fourth edition of this Sustainable Innovation Through Green Chemistry workshop. And we've got wonderful partners, and we've had these wonderful partners for a long time. So I want to acknowledge the NSERC Create in Green Chemistry and the Trace Institute for Sustainable Engineering and Design. And we're fortunate to have the generous and forward-thinking benefactor of the Trace Institute, Mr. Lauren Trace, here in the audience. And it's a real honor to have him here. Thank you. So I also want to acknowledge and thank wholeheartedly my colleagues who are co-organizers of this event, Professor Audrey Moores from Chemistry, who's also a member of the NSERC Create in Green Chemistry, and Professor Subhashis Ghoshal from Engineering, who's director of the Trace Institute. Now, I have to begin with both bad news and good news. Which would you like first? Okay. The bad news, unfortunately, our first planned keynote speaker, Professor Heather McLean, had to cancel at the last minute due to illness. She was not able to leave Toronto to get here. The good news is that our second planned keynote speaker is ready to go, can easily convert to being our sole keynote speaker, and she has a dynamite presentation lined up for you. But I will call on my colleague Audrey, Professor Audrey Moores, to come up and introduce our keynote speaker.
Well, thank you very much, Steve, for kickstarting this event. And it's really a great pleasure for us to be here today. It's fantastic for us in chemistry as well to be involved with management and with engineering in setting up this multidisciplinary event, which is starting with the lecture today, which we really look forward. So it's a pleasure for me to introduce Amy Cannon, Executive Director of Beyond Benign, the Foundation Beyond Benign. She's going to talk today about really interesting things. She's going to talk about innovation and biomimicry and how to make those things come together. So we're really excited about that. Amy is a really special person because she holds the first PhD in green chemistry in the world. So this is really quite something we have today. It was the University of Massachusetts who have a PhD in this field. So this is really unique. For that, she actually received an award, the Kenneth Hancock Memorial Award in 2004 for her work in titanium dioxide semiconductors, and she applied that to dye-sensitized solar cells. Before that, she did a BSc in chemistry from St. Anselm College in Manchester, New Hampshire, and after she went on and did an MSc in chemistry again from the University of Massachusetts in Boston. After her work, she became an assistant professor in green chemistry and also director of outreach and community education at the Center in Green Chemistry at the University of Massachusetts at Lowell. And in 2007, she left this position to actually co-found Beyond Benign, the nonprofit organization she now is directing. So she's also had an extensive industrial experience. She worked as an analytical chemist for Gillette Company and also from Rohm Haas Electronic Materials. So it's really an immense pleasure to have Amy today. She gave a fantastic talk yesterday about teaching in green chemistry, and students really loved her presentation, so I'm sure today is going to be an even better. So Amy, thank you so much for coming today, and it's a pleasure to have you.
All right, thank you. I'm going to leave that one right there. Okay, it's working. Great. Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me and for having me here today. I'm very excited to talk to you guys, and it sounds like a fantastic program that you have. So I congratulate all the students that are involved with this. So, and I look forward to hearing more throughout the day, too. So I'm going to talk a little bit about green chemistry and biomimicry. I thought might be a nice topic, because so often in green chemistry, we look around and we look into nature for inspiration. So it's just a nice point to talk about when we're talking about innovation as well. And I direct, I'm the executive director of Beyond Benign, as Audrey mentioned, a nonprofit organization. But I'm mostly going to be drawing from some examples that are coming out from the Warner Babcock Institute. So this is a for-profit research institution that's in the U.S. It's the first of its kind that's solely dedicated to green chemistry innovations. And we're co-located with them, so we're very lucky. And so I'm going to be kind of going back and forth a little bit at the beginning between these two, and then for some of the examples, I'm going to focus on the innovations coming out of Warner Babcock. So there's some really exciting things. Very briefly, this is our nonprofit. We were founded in 2007 when I had an opportunity to leave the university and start our own entities. We started at the same time, Beyond Benign and Warner Babcock, because at the university we were doing research and we were doing education. So we kind of divided and put all of our education work in the nonprofit, and we put our research and innovation work in Warner Babcock. So John Warner runs Warner Babcock, and I run Beyond Benign. And we both left the university at that point, so it was a great opportunity. But our bigger picture mission and vision is really aimed, and I spoke about this yesterday, at really transforming chemistry education so we can better support green chemistry in industry and really make a change. So in our programs span from K through 12, so middle and high school curriculum and training, to outreach with college students. We train college students to be ambassadors of green chemistry, to our higher ed green chemistry commitment work, where we're focused on getting resources out there and actually creating more resources so faculty and departments can implement green chemistry as well. So that's very briefly on Beyond Benign. And like I said, we're co-located with Warner Babcock, so we're very fortunate. And here we are. We're just north of Boston, so we're about 20 minutes with no traffic, which is rare. So we're just north of Boston. We have some great space. There's John and I, and Jim Babcock was our sole investor for this opportunity. And Jim Babcock actually was a venture capitalist out of California, and he met John and I and really believed in John's vision. So he was our single investor, and he also helped give us a start at Beyond Benign by giving us some support at the beginning. There's Joe Pont, who came out of the pharmaceutical industry. He's now our CEO. And if you're ever in the Boston area, come on up and visit us. I mean that. So this is a cross-section of our building. We have 42,000 square feet of space. Beyond Benign, we're down here in this corner, or wing of the building. We have a learning center where we bring students and classrooms in, and we actually provide trainings right in our building. There's our office space. But the rest of it is research lab space. So we have about 40 scientists, engineers, some biologists, physicists that are working in the labs, inventing some really exciting chemistry across really all industrial sectors. So I'm going to touch upon those. So again, we're pretty fortunate from an educational standpoint. We get to peek over the shoulders and are constantly seeing what's happening at Warner Babcock. And we're always trying to figure out how we can translate that into educational materials. So again, it can help get there out into our educational systems and help bring this so that all chemistry is green, you know, when we get out there, really. So again, I'm going to be drawing mostly from Warner Babcock today. So I've stolen quite a few slides from John Warner. And you'll know when I've stolen them from him, where you'll see that right down there. That's their logo, Warner Babcock. So they work in lots of different industrial sectors, which is pretty exciting. And they even have a couple spin-off companies that have come out of Warner Babcock. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about those when I get into some examples. But I wanted to take a step back and think about biomimicry for a minute. And if you're familiar with biomimicry, you might have seen some of these images. So I apologize if you're, you know, because these are some common examples of biomimicry. It's a pretty neat idea, and it's a pretty inspirational, I don't know if you'd call it a subject or field of study, but it's pretty neat. It's, you know, taking a look, seeing what's out there in nature, seeing how nature does chemistry, how nature does architecture, how nature does pretty much anything, and deriving inspiration from it. So looking at these examples really briefly, the Morphos butterfly, if you know this one, it's pretty cool. It doesn't derive its vibrant blue color from pigments, but instead it's a structural color. So it's actually little crystals in the layering of the wings where it gives it that vibrant blue. Same thing in my my wedding band here. I did a lot of research in titanium dioxide, as Audrey mentioned, and being a science nerd, I have a titanium ring, and it's titanium oxide in there. This was anodized, and it's really the surface, so it's particle size. If you pass a charge through it, it oxidizes the surfaces of the titanium, and depending on the particle size of the titanium, you can get different colors, you know, and how it reflects the light. So mine's blue. So again, this is structural color, it's not pigmentation. So same thing in the butterfly, and there's a company out of Japan that's creating this and turning this into fabrics. This monkey, chimpanzee really. So about 25% or so of all of our drugs and our medicines are derived from biological sources or extracted from biological sources. And if you think about all the different species that are out there, you know, if we as humans took each one and sort of combined them or extracted the active ingredients, it would take us billions and billions of years of research to really come up with some, you know, lead candidates for looking at some of these APIs and things. But if we look at, notice what these guys use to heal themselves, or you know, to heal themselves. Then we can get some inspiration from them. And surprisingly, so there's a good amount of leads that have happened that way. You may know this example too. And again, some of these are kind of bigger, higher level ones that are out there quite a bit when you talk about biomimicry. This is a kingfisher bird, which when it dives into get its fish in the water, the aerodynamics of that beak, it doesn't make a splash. And this is helpful, beneficial for this because it's a really good fisher. So it goes in, grabs those fish. So in Japan, they used and created these trains that aerodynamically just cut through the air with very minimal friction to hugely reduce the sound. So these are super, super quiet, really fast trains. I like this example because it's more of a chemistry example. This little beetle lives in the desert, and if you take a close look at his back, you can see drops of water coming off of his back in very arid climates. And that's because of the surface has these little hydrophobic and hydrophilic pieces on it that grab water from the air and then they beat up on the surface. So this company has created something, I guess, inspired by, that can actually harvest water in very, very arid climates. I like this example too because it works really well in a room like this. If you just pause in any room where you are anywhere, you always can hear fans running. So you always hear that fan, which is really resistance from the inefficiency of our fans and it cutting through the air. So there's this is a PAX fan. They took a look at, this is seaweed that sort of go in and out of with the waves, and they cut really nicely with very minimal friction through the water. So PAX fan is created, this is Jay Harmon's work, created some fans, again, no sound, very minimal friction, and also ends up being much more efficient energy-wise. Another more chemistry example, this is a lotus leaf where, you know, these beautiful lotus leaves are nice and smooth, and water and things just bead right up and come right off, and they're always very clean because of the surface morphology, where water just really catches the dirt and things that come off. And they're designing some self-cleaning windows and that sort of thing based on this sort of surface chemistry. The last example that I last bigger picture example that I have is the mussels here. This guy, Professor Lee out at Oregon State, was walking along the beach. You might have also heard this example too, and noticed these guys who had these really amazing adhesives that stuck really well in an aqueous environment, and they actually are really cool because they release. They can trigger and release just like that too. But so he created some proteins or some adhesives based on similar chemistry, protein chemistry, to create some formaldehyde-free plywood. I have a little bit more of an extension and more of explanation on Warner Babcock's also working on some adhesives. So I'm going to talk about that a little later. So these kind of big picture ideas came, a lot of them come from Biomimicry 3.8, which is Janine Benyus's company. This book is a great book if you haven't come across it yet. It's published back in 98, but still pretty inspirational. And she also has some wonderful talks out there if you want to learn more about biomimicry. But I like to start with that because it's a good platform for thinking about how, you know, again, green chemistry and then how these two worlds collide. So how does it relate to green chemistry? Well, one is just how nature does chemistry. And if you think about how we've done chemistry for over 150 years, over 180 years or so of modern chemistry, it's typically that heat, beat, and treat, right? We heat things to high temperatures, we apply high pressures, use organic solvents. But if we look at nature and how nature actually performs chemistry, it outperforms us all the time in complexity and simplicity at the same time. Reactions are run at essentially room temperature many times, ambient pressure, and water as a solvent. I mean, it's this amazing chemistry, and you get these really complex systems. So one way of, you know, relating these two fields is just looking at how and watching and seeing how nature does chemistry. Another one is this guy. Do you guys know what this guy is doing? It's that, I don't know if you've seen this image before, but it's this gecko adhesive that he's got, and it's so strong that you can hang, that this guy can hang off the ceiling from it. You might have also seen that picture. That one's been out there a lot for this gecko adhesive. Really, really interesting stuff. You know, looking at the gecko's little, it's not really a foot, is it? Or what is it? Anyway, but looking at a gecko and taking a look at, and looking at, you see these small little nanostructures that actually make a really nice adhesive to surfaces, which is super cool, you know, super cool. But I always have to ask the question, that is great, hugely, you know, hugely inspirational. But how is this made? A lot of times we find that some of these really great, neat examples of biomimicry use a lot of the traditional chemistry that we've been using for over 150 years. So that's where green chemistry comes in. So you have this beautiful, you know, inspirational examples from biomimicry and from nature, but let's figure out how to translate that into real, into, you know, greener chemistry in the laboratory as well. And I think about that, so I apologize to those of you who were at my talk yesterday, because I have a few slides that are you know, from yesterday as well, so I apologize about that if I'm repeating myself to you guys. But just a couple, again, to frame it for those who are not in the green chemistry field. or not as familiar with it anyway. I think about this when I was back at Roman Haas Electronic Materials. I worked there for a couple years before I went into academia. And we were designing silicon-based polymers for optical electronics, so waveguide materials. And in our group meetings, we had a certain design criteria for these polymers. We had to have a certain solubility because we were coating it onto a surface. It had to have certain thermal properties, so it had to have melting point, glass transition temperature, all these chemical and physical properties of the material. And we discussed them at length in our group meetings because you want to make a product that's going to work, right? So it also had to have these mechanical properties. So for this waveguide material, it also had to have some strength and modulus to it, all these performance criteria, refractive index because we're bending light. Anyway, we went on and on in our group meetings. And then what wasn't part of our discussion in our group meetings until I got there was, what about toxicity and environmental impact? And shouldn't we consider that as a chemical or physical property and also that it should be part of our design criteria? And that just as if I poorly designed a poor polymer that had poor properties up here, I would go in and redesign that polymer, right, to make it better. Same thing, we can think about these really as design flaws if we're including this in our design criteria, and we can design these properties out of our materials. So just having that, I think, brings us into a different space for innovation, for innovating. Just thinking about, these sort of, it's a different, what if it's through a slightly different lens. So, and that's where, so green chemistry, one of the key aspects of green chemistry, or one of this is a sort of the big, I guess the main heart of, I think, what green chemistry is about is, yes, you're designing materials that are just are better environmentally and health-wise than other alternatives. But as you're developing, it also has to have those performance. It also has to have just as good or better performance. So someone's not going to, buy that green cleaner that left streaks down your glass that didn't work. You're not going to go back and buy it if it had poor performance. And you're also not going to pay a premium for that green cleaner, or maybe not too much of a premium. So we have to have the economics. So all three of these things together is when we get green chemistry. And that's really what makes it so hard, what we do. So green chemistry, I talk a lot about the education side of green chemistry, but it really is about so many of these performance things which speak a lot to industry, reducing cost, enhancing performance, and innovation. And the costs really have to do, of course, with no one wants to use a hazardous material if they don't, they're using it if they don't have another alternative or don't have the time to actually research and develop an alternative, because it's expensive for all of these reasons. It costs more to store it, to transport it, treat it, disposal, regulatory costs, liability, worker health and safety, all of these things. New employee recruitment, more and more students today want to work for companies that are contributing to a greater good. So it's expensive to use hazardous materials, and we're not going to if we don't have to. I showed this one yesterday too, so sorry. For those of you who were there, in the U.S., this is John's tally of environmental regulations over the past 150 years or so. Not much happened until about 1962 when Rachel Carson published Silent Spring. Don't ever underestimate that one person can change the world. Then we see an exponential explosion of regulations in the U.S., and some would argue we still don't have enough. But this is also, when industry looks at this is also a cost of doing business. So this is where, if we can move away from some of the chemistry that's regulated, then we're going to be also looking at cost benefits as well. And green chemistry is not going away. This is a great, or green chemicals, it's not going away. This is a Pike Research study that came out in 2011. And like I said yesterday, we're already here. So this is what it says. By 2020, another 4 years, the green chemical market will be a $100 billion market. And so this to me says, again, it's not a passing fad. We're not going to look back and say, wasn't that silly when we cared about humans and the environment? Like, no, this is real, and this is where we need to move. This is where we need to move our technologies and our chemistry too. So with that, I'm going to go through some examples. And again, a lot of them I'm going to pull from Warner Babcock. Some I'm going to pull from some of the work that I've done in the past, which is still related to Warner Babcock as well. So some of my work was done in dye-sensitized solar cells. And so traditional solar energy devices, the ones that are most widely used today, are silicon-based. And forgive me if some of you are in solar energy, you probably can tell me a lot more than I'm going to say up here. But basically, the silicon-based ones, there's no getting around the melting point of silicon right now. It's 1,500 degrees Celsius, which means it's very energy intensive to make these things. You're melting silicon and you're growing these wafers. Although, if somebody could figure it out, there's an organism in the ocean that actually creates these silicon structures, these silicon sponge-like materials. If somebody can figure out how that organism processes the silicon, we're going to be in a lot better space, I think. But right now, there's no getting around this. And then the processing of this also uses some quite hazardous materials as well. So we've been looking at really shifting towards more something that's more inspired by something like leaves and trees. So low-cost, non-toxic materials, low energy, and short buyback times. So that led us to look at titanium dioxide dye-sensitized solar cells. You can see my electron flows here. And what was so interesting about these, they were back in 1991, Michael Gretzel was the first one to put one of these together, so they're oftentimes called Gretzel cells as well. But what's interesting about these is that you're not growing these wafers, you're actually coating these layers, which opens up, you know, the opportunity for perhaps creating a solar energy device that might be able to use as a paint, you know, or you can put it on flexible substrates or something like that. So it was an exciting innovation. And basically, you have a sensitizer dye that sort of captures energy from the sun and injects an electron into your semiconductor and comes around. It's completed a circuit by this iodine electrolyte system, and you've got your little solar energy device. This is a traditional one. So what we did is we took a look at that titanium dioxide semiconductor layer right there and how that was processed. And for the chemistry people in the audience, there's a little bit more chemistry here. For the business folks, I'm sorry. So it's kind of this back and forth a little bit. But basically, how these are typically made, it's called a sol gel process, where you're taking a titanium alkoxide here and you're hydrolyzing it, and then you're growing these little balls, essentially, of your titanium dioxide. And then what you have to do is you traditionally have to heat it still to pretty high temperatures, 450 degrees Celsius, to actually make a nice film for these semiconductors. So, and that's, you know, helps link those little balls, sort of balls together. But you still get a pretty crappy film. So this is an SEM, scanning electron microscope image. So you still get a crappy one. So oftentimes a binder is used to put in this to help link it together. And you actually have to heat it up that high so that you can burn off your binder so it doesn't interfere with, you know, some of the electrical and physical properties. So what we did is we said, well, what else makes nice films and hard surfaces, but doesn't have to spend, you know, 450 degree oven? Well, let's think about bones and shells and that sort of calcification process. And if you look at the calcification process, we've got a much simpler simpler molecule than what's in our bones and our shells, but proteins sort of chaperone that process and they pull the pieces together and you get a nice bone and you get a nice shell. And again, I didn't have to spend time in an oven to make my nice bones. So what we did is we found this is one of the molecules. But these simple molecules where we just are magic frou-frou dust that we, you know, put in there, and it helps bind them together. And essentially, we now can process these at room temperature, and you make a really nice film. So this is our traditional one, and here's our SEM image on about the same scale here. This is micron scale here, and you get a much nicer film here. It turns out we actually needed a lot less than what I've got here. That's a 2.5% anyway, and we can actually use other types of small little acids here just by thinking about and, you know, moving outside and seeing how else can we do this? So that's one example. Another example, this is actually out of the edge, out of some of the Beyond Benign work that we've been doing. We partnered with Steelcase, which is a furniture company out of Grand Rapids, Michigan. And they're working on using some of this sharklet, this another company called Sharklet. They're using some of these films to put onto their office environments and some of the chairs and things so they can be antimicrobial surfaces. So sharks have these denticles here, which kind of look like this. This is a micron scale here, micron scale. It's about the same scale as what you see here. But if you look at sharks, they have nice smooth skin. If you can actually get close and pat a shark, they have nice smooth. And they don't get build up, they don't get algae and stuff building up on these surfaces. So what some scientists did said, let's take a closer look, and you get these little denticles here. And because of the surface structure of the shark skin, you actually get these antimicrobial, it's not really antimicrobial, it's like a bacteria stat. So it's a static surface where microbes and stuff can't grow. They really inhibits the growth. So what Sharklet did was create similar structures here based on or inspired by the shark skin. And you actually get these bacteriostatic films or surfaces just from changing the surface chemistry. So it's a little bit different. And this is taking a step back and saying, okay, instead of dealing with and thinking about how to create an antimicrobial agent, what we would typically do is add something into a formulation that might leach out into the environment. That's might be how we might approach that problem. Well, they took a step back and said, how else does nature do this? And thinking about having the surface actually being a bacteriostat as opposed to leaching something out. So this we actually created, we've worked with Steelcase and we created a whole module around this for high schools. So if you have any connections with any high schools in your area, it's a fun module. And it's in all of our educational materials on Beyond Benign are posted on our website and downloadable free of charge, open access. And so that's one of our green chemistry and industry modules that's up there. So some Warner Babcock examples. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about Warner Babcock. I am fortunate enough to be married to John Warner, so I do know quite a bit about what goes on there, so that's good. So hopefully, if you do have more specific questions about Warner Babcock, I can do it justice and answer them for you, too. And he didn't mind me stealing his slides, too, so it makes it easier to steal slides from your husband. So, like I said, Warner Babcock works in all different industrial sectors, and really, the research is pretty wide and vast. And it's interesting, John's background is he's a medicinal chemist by training. He spent time in industry at Polaroid Corporation, heading exploratory research. So he's got this really interesting background, which again spans all kinds of industrial sectors. And what we started with at Warner Babcock for about the first 4 years was contract invention, we called it. So working directly with a company would come and say, okay, I've got this. Sometimes they would come just wanting to solve a problem, and John's a good innovator, but also has a green lens to it, so it could be problem solving. But sometimes a company would come and say, well, I've got this great water-based paint, but it's got poor performance, so can you help us from the performance aspect? Because again, it's not going to be successful if you don't have the performance. So We called ourselves a contract invention firm. For about the first 4 years, that's what we did. Worked directly with companies all through contract invention. And so we would event for collaborators and help with commercialization, or again, sometimes just problem solving for companies. And then essentially hand that invention back over to companies. Now for the past three, almost 4 years, the model has been about half contract invention with companies and half self-funded inventions. So Babcock said, you know what, John, what are some big ideas that you have that you think could be brought to market? And John had six of them, and I'm gonna talk about all six of them today because they're all successful that they started working on. They're all been really great. So, and from this self-funded invention, they've spun off a couple new companies, collaborative aggregates and collaborative medicinal development. And I'm going to talk a little bit about those too, and how that all works together as well. But Warner Babcock's pretty interesting, because if you take an idea, and I know some people in the audience have a lot more experience than I personally do on this, but if you take an idea and bring it to market or create a new company, there's kind of two paths. One is from a science side and one is from a business side. And there's a lot of different aspects in this that you guys can probably all relate to here too. And oftentimes we have what's called technology incubators, where we sort of launch these ideas and get them commercialized. Warner Babcock's really, we call it a technology greenhouse. We're kind of nurturing these ideas and bringing them to realization. And Warner Babcock kind of lives right in this space within, from an idea or explore basic research or some of these early points to commercialization. But we live kind of right in here, Warner Babcock. So we're taking ideas, creating potentially useful prototypes, and getting them to a certain point, and then someone else takes them to commercialization. So we're kind of right there in the middle. That's to give you an idea of where Warner Babcock operates. So Warner Babcock has a parent company called Cthulhu, for all you science fiction nerds out there. So Cthulhu Ventures, which is really Jim Babcock's venture right now. So that's the parent company there. And then from Warner Babcock, we've spun off collaborative medicinal development and collaborative aggregates. And Beyond Benign is a separate nonprofit, but we're co-located with them, so we're kind of affiliated, and we have, we're the same founder in both. So we're kind of an extension, I guess, a little bit different, but. And out of collaborative aggregates, we have a company called Delta S, or a product called Delta S, which I'm going to talk about. It has to do with asphalt. And then Oncochel, which is an oncology drug, and Procipra, which is a Alzheimer's drug. So I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit about those, and I'll bring in the biomimicry. A lot of the examples do include some biomimicry in it, and some don't. So that's the nature of what we do. So the first one I'll talk about is the pharmaceutical and agricultural products. So this is a Parkinson's disease drug, which it was this molecule that John came across, and it's actually a collaboration out of Australia. And it had really great activity. It's called copper ATSM. It had really great activity, but the solubility was a pretty big issue here. So it was soluble in DMSO, and you had to use some other surfactants and things to actually deliver it into, to get it across the blood-brain barrier where you need it to be to have it to do its thing. But what John did was, and some of the work was also funded by Michael J. Fox Foundation there in the U.S. too. Some of the trials were. But what John did was he said, all right, well, if solubility is an issue, how else can we approach this? And what through non-covalent, you'll see in some of the patent names, non-covalent derivatization. So, and I'm going to talk a little bit about this, because this also goes to some work that I did in my master's degree. I worked a lot in non-covalent derivatization. But just by non-covalently complexing this molecule with some innocuous molecules, he changed the solubility drastically. So it was, so now you can actually get, and then also increase the activity at the same time. So now, you know, only nanogram, really small quantities are actually needed for this, and can actually deliver these across the blood-brain barrier. Because you couldn't get, again, you can use DMSO, you can use surfactants in some of the animal studies when you're doing this, but those you cannot put those in humans. So we increase the oral bioavailability significantly through this, and it was all through non-covalent hybridization. So to explain this a little bit more, I'm going to use a simple hydroquinone molecule because this is just really simple chemistry. And I can't tell you all of the stuff from the last page too. A lot of it I can't, you know, talk about all the chemistry because it's proprietary and that sort of thing. But so if we took this hydroquinone molecule and we wanted to make it less water soluble, how we traditionally, as traditional chemists, how we traditionally would approach this is we would derivatize it. So we would blast it and, you know, create, make and break bonds. And up here on the screen, adding that little methyl group looks pretty simple. But in reality, in the lab, you're using pretty hazardous materials, high temperatures. So, you know, a lot of, this is how we would traditionally approach something like this. But if you take a step back and say, well, what I really want to do is change the physical properties, how else can I do this? And what we find is that if we actually complex it with another molecule through hydrogen bonding and self-assembly, we can change the same change in physical property, but we haven't manipulated the actual covalent chemistry so you preserve the efficacy of that active ingredient, so to say, the hydroquinone, but you complex it. Through hydrogen bonding, through non-covalent hybridizations. And just by the nature of this chemistry, it ends up being low energy. Oftentimes we don't even need any reagents, and oftentimes we can do it solvent-free. So a lot of times to make these non-covalent derivatives, it's solid grinding, which I know you guys do some of that chemistry here at the university. So it's solid state chemistry, it's mechanical grinding, it's simple chemistry. And again, you can just, and so it's a different way of thinking. And we call this molecular psychology. So instead of, you know, again, the traditional way of making molecules, you know, because we are amazing chemists, right? Like we can do, I'm not talking about myself, I'm talking about you guys who are chemistry. But we can make, if we can draw a molecule, doesn't violate any rules up here on the board, we can make it. It's just, do we have a way? So we can make some pretty incredible chemistry. But if you take a molecule and sort of lay it down and say, what do you want to do? Then, you know, and you understand the non-covalent tendencies, if you understand sort of what it wants to do, then you're going to be in a better place environmentally. The Alzheimer's disease drug is pretty cool. John's a medicinal chemist too, so he can give you much more information about this one too. But basically what they started with was this cathulanol. Again, science fiction nerds here, cathulanol. depending on these functional groups here, they came up with a lead here. And they came up with a lead here, and just by changing some of the functionality here, this is the effective concentration where 50% of the population sees an effect. So this is where we, just by changing this was more traditional derivatization that they did on this molecule, this system. But in a short period of time, through a green chemistry lens, they actually drastically increased the activity. So now they only need nanogram quantities to actually have this function. And what this guy does, more of how this one functions, is through non-covalent forces, where it gets in there and breaks up some of the aggregates that are being formed on the brain. And it gets right in there non-covalently. This one is an oncology drug, which again, reliazine, this one's pretty cool. This one is also, depending on the functional groups, it can actually target different kinds of cancer. So in the US, the NIH offers some free trials for leads that look like they could potentially have big impact for, you know, as cancer treatment drugs. And so this one, they sent one of the few derivatives of this molecule to the NIH to be tested, and they tested along 71 different cancer lines. And one of them came back, and it actually stopped growth on all 71, and it had no toxicity. So it didn't kill other cells, you know, because cancer, essentially fast-growing molecules. Molecules, systems, fast-growing cells. So what they did after that, too, is then dialed in some more specificity to with these functional groups, and they can target different kinds of cancer. So this one's a pretty cool one. And then in the same company, they're also working in materials and composites. So we go from, you know, oncology drugs and Alzheimer's to pavement. And they're actually kind of related, which is interesting. So John is always looking, you know, to see whatever chemistry he's using in one industrial sector to see where it might apply in other places, because, you know, chemistry can be similar across the disciplines too. So there's about a billion or so miles of road that we have. So we have a lot of pavement, a lot of asphalt on our earth. And like, I think it's about 10% of it or so is repaved every year. And that's because, you know, it's oxidized by the sun and you know, it breaks down. And it's so you have the surfaces that break up and that sort of thing. This is our house in Wilmington. So, you know, being married to John, we're often the test cases for some of these things. So we had a perfectly good driveway, but he said, I'm going to dig up our driveway and put some new asphalt on it because we're doing this trial run. So I said, okay. And it was 2 years ago that they did this now, and it was right around Thanksgiving. And for us, it was super cold, which maybe for you guys isn't as cold, but it was really cold at the time for us. And what they did is they had a new formulation out of collaborative aggregates here that used over 50% of recycled material. So when companies now that when they come and repave roads, they might be able to use 5 or 10% of the same asphalt and recycle it back into the new asphalt. But because it's so oxidized and crumbly and that sort of thing, they can't use any more than that. It will just fall apart, really. It just won't function. So they've created this magic, I call it magic frou-frou dust again, but this another little additive that's a rejuvenator that they put into it, and they can use over 50% recycled material. And the idea for this, the big, you know, far-off goal, is that you have, you know, if you're on the highway and they're paving one side of the road, they have those machines, you know, we're envisioning a machine that might, you know, grab the stuff, rework it, and then lay it right back down right there on the spot. And right now what they do is they take, you know, they take all the asphalt off, and then they put it, most of it, in a landfill. And then again, like I said, 10% might come back into the road. And some also roof shingles are used quite a bit in that too, for to put back part in it. And the other thing you can't do with traditional asphalt is you can't pave at low temperatures. You need it to be warmer. So what collaborative aggregate through Delta S, this product, you can now pave at really cold temperatures too, which might be valuable to you guys up here, because I hear it's quite cold most of a big part of the year up here. So there we are. That's our driveway now, and it looks great, and it's held up great. They've got some trials, or they are paving. They're actually selling this product. Again, it's Delta S, which science folks, Delta S, change in entropy, right? So it's kind of a nice, yeah, we're nerds. Our driveway was the first, and now it's being used in parking lots. They're looking at, you know, lots of contracts with big companies to use this in their pavement and different different companies, and they're also doing some trials in different parts. So they're in like most of the states in the U.S. right now. And there they are. How that one works is basically, I can't give you the exact chemistry on it, but basically you've got your asphalt up here, and the red parts have been oxidized. So there's a certain part of this polymer, this asphalt polymer, so to say, that's been oxidized, and that's the part that makes it crumbly and break apart and that sort of thing. So what this magic molecule does, our delta S molecule, it looks like a little house there. It kind of goes in there and breaks it up, breaks up the big, large aggregates. And then you mix it up, and then it kind of turns around. So you have one part of the molecule that breaks up the aggregate, and then you have the other side of the molecule that kind of redocks or it has an affinity for the actual polymer. So then it sort of binds back to the polymer, and you get a nice, you get your nice asphalt back. So it's kind of this interesting. So John uses this image, and I'm just going to pull it up because it's kind of funny, where here's John in his asphalt. He gets a call, and he's talking to somebody about his clinical trials for his Parkinson's disease drug. And he's standing on his asphalt, and he says, you know, a lot of times people think these are two different worlds. But if you think about it, it's kind of the same chemistry, where you have something that's going in there, breaking up these aggregates. It's breaking up aggregates in your brain. It's breaking up aggregates in the asphalt. And then you're putting something else in there that has the efficacy. So it's there again, asphalt, Parkinson's disease drugs, they're a lot more related than you think. And you know, always, you know, looking through a lens of seeing what else you can do with this chemistry is another platform for innovation. Formaldehyde-free wood composites, back in the US, and we had Hurricane Katrina, and there was all these FEMA trailers that were brought down to the area, and they all had these particle boards and the OSB boards and plywood, and they were off-gassing formaldehyde, so people were getting sick. We had lots of cases of people getting sick, and you hear this a lot too, the off-gassing of formaldehyde. And so what they were moving towards was something called MDI, so methylene diphenyl isocyanate. And that also not so good. So this is actually, they came up with a bio-based natural process. It's different from the one that I started off with that came out of Columbia Forest products. That product ended up having not quite the performance that some of the formaldehyde plywood and particle board has. But these, they were up here in Canada, so up in Edmonton, and they did a huge run on, I don't know, it was a really large run, where they made a bunch of these boards to try them out. And the performance that they're getting back is just as good as the formaldehyde and the MDI boards. But these are all bio-based. So super exciting. I think this was last winter. They were also quite cold. a theme up here. So that's exciting. We're also working in cosmetics and personal care. So this one's also some pretty neat examples up here. This is a happy beetle up here. I'm just going to pull up some of these because, okay, so this beetle, so it's called bug sclerotization. And when a bug loses its exoskeleton, it then becomes white and gushy. And then it restores its color over a pretty short amount of time. That's bug sclerotization. So turns out that in the US, you can buy this product called Grecian formula. It's often targeted towards men. And the commercials are fantastic, where you have these, you know, little girls going, "Daddy, daddy, dye your hair so you can get a date." And because apparently, anyway, but the active ingredient in those is actually lead tetraacetate. So the girls are asking for the lead. I don't know. It's just really messed up commercials. But in the U.S., I don't think you can buy this in Canada. I'm pretty sure it's banned in Canada because you guys, because it's obvious. not to us in the U.S. So basically what this does is it gradually restores hair color back to its original color. So and what it's doing is you're depositing lead on your hair follicle. over a short period, over, you know, gradually. So, and that's nice for men because they don't like to go to the salon and all of a sudden you've got your dyed hair and everybody knows, right? So it's a little bit better for men to do it gradually. So this beetle, you know, does the same sort of process. It's for you biochemists, a tyrosinase cascade here. That's the chemistry. So they looked at that chemistry and they said, can we do something similar in hair color? And so they got these hair samples from people who provide hair samples. And it was kind of cool. They used this chemistry similar to the chemistry that you see over here. And it actually, they got a mixture of colors. But what was happening is that when you actually go and buy hair to test on new hair formulations, they give you mixtures of people's hair that has been donated. So at first they thought, okay, this is really uneven, the dye's not coming out, but then they realized it was mixtures of hair. So they were actually restoring your natural color of gray. So there's John. He's not only the president, but he's also a client. Do you guys remember those commercials? So that's, if you go to myhairprint.com, you can see a video of him before and after. It's kind of funny. So there he is. And this is, again, being president of the company, he's the first one to try it out. So he was constantly getting his hair dyed because they were trying a new formulation. So any given time that you'd meet him, you'd either have brown hair or gray hair. So, and then it also turns black hair black and like a brown to a brown. So again, it restores your natural hair color, which is pretty exciting. So this is now licensed to a company called The Nature of Hair, and the actual product is called My Hair Print, and you can go on myhairprint.com and buy it now. So it's out there. So this is a different model for a company that Warner Babcock has done. They, instead of creating, they didn't want to get into the hair dyeing business, so they handed it off to someone who licensed it, and they brought it to commercialization. So that's different from, say, the plywood and the asphalt where they did themselves. So, and how this one works is basically, and the way that it restores the, so a little bit of the chemistry, again, we can't give you all the chemistry, is you've got this formulation up here. This is what it looks like if you buy a box of it. And you start mixing it up, and you get these little aggregates of color, and it gets darker and darker. And so you create these sort of, again, like these aggregates. And what it does is, you know, we talk about it like, you know, when you lose your color, when you lose your pigmentation in your hair, you kind of lose a piece of it. And each color, everybody's hair has different sort of orientation of these molecules. And you can think of it like a parking lot, where you could arrange cars in lots of different ways in a parking lot. And that's kind of like in your hair. So when you lose that piece, and say the lead example, what lead does is it deposits in the spots, like cars, in that parking lot to restore your normal hair color. Same thing that My Hair Print does too. It kind of lodges in those spots in different orientations, whatever your orientation is in your hair. So it kind of lodges like cars parked in the parking lot to get whatever color your hair naturally is. And many of us women don't even know what hair, what color, what original hair color that we had. So that'll be interesting to find out. So anyway, and then we also got into this crazy. This is some of the weird stuff I did in graduate school. Doesn't everyone do weird stuff in graduate school, in or out of the lab? So basically, we had this chemistry based, inspired by skin cancer, actually. So this is one of the mechanisms of skin cancer is that thymine, two adjacent thymine molecules in your DNA will actually, when UV light hits it, you'll get a 2pi plus 2pi photodimerization. You get a kink in your DNA. Luckily, we have enzymes that come in and snip that out and then replicate it back. But when that self-repairing mechanism fails, it's one of the mechanisms of skin cancer. So this was used so we said, okay, let's put that in a polymer and let's use that for photochemistry. So this thymine molecule is a photoresist, essentially. So it's a photo trigger that we put into a polymer backbone. And we've used it for things like hair curling and fabric shaping, like putting pleats and things in fabrics. some of the some other examples that are less less linked to biomimicry fall under sort of the sustainability sciences area. And this one, these are pretty cool. One has to do with ocean plastics. You know, as if you guys are familiar with this issue, we have a big issue of plastics building up in our oceans. And so there's some organizations that are trying to figure out what to do with this, how to reclaim them, are there some things that we can do with it, and then, of course, the next generation would be, how do you create plastics so they're not gonna build up in our oceans to begin with? So back last summer, John was on stage at the United Nations in New York City with this organization called Parlay, and they're all about this issue of ocean plastics. And if you just go, you know, Google that, they have some really horrifying but very interesting images about all the challenges here. And if you guys ever seen Whale Wars, if anyone ever seen Whale Wars, it's one of those quote-unquote reality shows where this is the Sea Shepherd, the boat that they follow around. And on one of the shows, they picked up a bunch of fishing net. Fishing net often gets left behind from fishers in the ocean. So they picked up a large amount of fishing net. And then they sent a bunch of boxes to Warner Babcock because they did. Because they were connected with Parlay. And John had been working with that organization on this issue because there's lots of people trying to figure out what they can do with ocean plastics. Are there anything useful that we can do with it? So at Warner Babcock, what they did in a very quick amount of time is they took the ocean net and they spun it into a nylon fiber, which they then sent to Adidas in Germany, and they created a shoe. So coming out this year, they have an ocean plastic shoe that will be coming out that you can buy, made from, you know, nets from the ocean. I mean, again, this is one, it's not going to solve the issue of ocean plastics, but it's going to bring more attention to the issue. And again, the next phase of this is to, you know, create plastics that either, degrade into innocuous byproducts out there, or again, work on our infrastructure issue, why the plastics are getting out there in the first place. So that's kind of a neat one. We also have, this one's kind of interesting too. They came up with a way of taking limonene. Limonene is a great solvent that's used in some cases, although it is an irritant, so it's not used, or it's an irritant to a small subset of the population anyway. But it's extracted from orange peels. And what they did is they hydrolyzed about 50% of the limonene and came up with this really interesting solvent, and that enabled them to actually extract lithium cobalt out of lithium ion batteries through this sort of quote-unquote benign solvent system. And so they can recover, so it's really a way of recovering some of the lithium that's in these batteries and then creating more of our lithium ion batteries. So this is in collaboration with a company, ATMI. Another thing that they're working on, which is kind of interesting, and I think has to do with, this also has to do with some of the chemistry that I worked on. So taking these water harvesting technologies, which again is a little bit similar to, you know, remember that beetle, the beetle butt that I showed you at the beginning. But this one's a little bit different, where you have a switchable molecule that goes back and forth from hydrophobic to hydrophilic. And you can imagine if you have a surface that the hydrophobic part, your water is going to beat up. Hydrophilic part, it's going to more spread out or be attracted to it. So what they're working on creating is essentially these systems. This is more illustrative. It's not exact what they're creating. But they're creating these systems. So imagine if you had like a little rowboat with an umbrella in the ocean. And it had this switchable molecule on it that's triggered by sun. So when you shine light on it, it's hydrophilic. So during the day, it's collecting water. And then at night, when it's dark, it actually turns back to hydrophobic. So it goes back. So it's triggered by light, goes back and forth. This would be working on like a 24-hour system, and then essentially you get, you know, your water coming down, sort of raining. I don't know that it would be raining in there, but you know, it's dropping down, and you're collecting your fresh water. They're working on creating like a, you know, this on a much shorter time scale using a fan to trigger on and off with the lights to actually get some water harvesting. I think I only have a couple really quick examples here. Performance materials. They worked with a company to come up with a technology through non-covalent derivatization, again, to actually make sugar sweeter. So it's, again, this is through non-covalent derivatization, actually creating complexes that sort of allow sugar to sort of linger longer. So you actually have this new class of sweeteners based on sugar where you can use half of it. And you know, as you know, some of the health implications of some of our artificial sweeteners aren't so good. So people are looking at different ways of making sugar sweeter. So it was interesting chemistry there too. The last one, I think this is the last one that I've got, has to do with some films and coatings. And we're still doing quite a bit. This is in solar cells, so you can see some of our work in the dye-sensitized solar cells that we've been extrapolating on some of the chemistry that I started with some of the examples here. And we're doing a lot more in solar and electronics. We're still working on that area. Also working on BPA free thermal printing. You guys here in Canada spawned a whole ban on BPA in Nalgene bottles and baby bottles and things like that, which was fantastic. But turns out that, you know, BPA is also found in cash register receipts in the free form. So it's not bound in a polymer like it is in polycarbonate, but it's actually free form on there in, you know, large quantities. And John got interviewed quite a bit about this because he brought this up one day and even made it into this nice prestigious journal, Woman's World, where he, you know, pointed out that BPAs and thermal cash. Oh, with on the same page was with a cat pushing a shopping carriage. It was great. We saved that article. So they're working on ways to do this. It works a little bit like the hair chemistry, actually. It's similar to the hair chemistry that they're doing to make these thermal cash register receipts that are BPA free. So I hope I gave you kind of a good snapshot of what's going on at Warner Babcock. Again, come visit us if you're in the area. We'd be happy to host you. I'm going to leave you with one of John's slides that I really like, but I'm not going to try to explain because I won't be able to do it justice. But he's got these five elements of innovation that he talks about, and I really think they're interesting just to reflect upon. You know, all innovation starts with science fiction. So it's some crazy idea, and somebody will tell you it's a crazy idea. Whether or not you believe them and take that risk is another thing. So oftentimes innovation involves risk, right? It's gonna involve you taking a leap and taking some risk. Innovation, you're always look in the periphery. You know, John has got this amazing ability to take, you know, to put things together in ways that I've never seen. Of course, I'm biased, right? I told you that we're married. but you know, always thinking about how whatever chemistry you're doing might apply across multiple disciplines or outside that your area of focus is something I think that also, you know, can create a really great innovative space. Biomimicry is one lens. I mean, always, you know, looking around to see what happens out there doesn't always have to be the lens, but it's one way. And oftentimes, innovation is simple. It doesn't have to be complex. Oftentimes, it's a lot simpler than you think. So I leave you with that. And again, green chemistry, just by bringing a couple things more into that, you're looking at your chemistry and your design in different ways. So with that, I'm going to leave you my email address. I have John's up there too, in our websites, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Well, Amy, thank you so much for this inspirational talk. I'm sure that there'll be plenty of questions from the audience.
Do you want to use this or that?
It would be,
Either, I guess.
Hi. So I had a question about the non-covalent derivatizations.
Yeah.
I was just wondering how they actually deliver across the blood-brain barrier. So it's an interesting concept because you're right, normally you would play around the hydrophobicity, hydrophilicity, the charge to get it more soluble or whatnot. But then once it's actually in that aggregate, how do you get it to go across the blood-brain barrier?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. I work with delivery, so I was very curious, actually.
You probably know more about that than I do. I don't know. All I know is that it does get there. And it's just the efficacy went through the roof there, too. So it is getting across the blood-brain barrier, but I don't know the actual mechanism.
Okay, thank you.
So.
My question is more general about the toxicity, like the assessment of the toxicity of the products that you have, like, let's say the hair dye, like,
yeah.
If he tests himself, he probably is very confident that it's not right. Toxic, but do you also deal with that in the company?
Yeah, we do, and we also have some work that we're doing internally on creating some ways of testing that don't include animal testing.
Yeah.
So they're working on some tissue engineering and actually, you know, growing tissues and things in so they can do quick tests of toxicity. It depends on the product, definitely depends on the product for toxicity. You know, some of them absolutely require it, like obviously all the pharmaceuticals, they have to go through strict testing of both efficacy and toxicity. And some of the other ones, like cosmetics, are completely not regulated at all, so they don't require any testing. That's not to say that we shouldn't do it. But some of those have, it's going to be different tests or much more simpler tests, obviously, than pharmaceuticals, which are very regulated. But most of the chemistry that we do uses kind of common, or not common chemicals, but chemicals that have already been tested elsewhere. And that we know the toxicity elsewhere. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a combination of some in-house quick tests and some...
And also trying to avoid the use of animals.
Yes.
And then,
yeah. Yeah, our Babcock is very, very against animal testing, so we don't do it. But obviously, you'd have to do it in pharmaceuticals. Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, thanks again for your talk. It was really, wish I would have become a chemist, actually. But do you think, I know you're an academic, but do you think in the culture of innovation, things aren't really built to last anymore? Mm-hmm. And asphalt's a great example here in Montreal, where, you know, certain powers that be make you reliant on having to repave every year because that makes them money. So do you think that there is a culture of making things to last longer, to be better, so that we don't have to be buying things every year, but that a solid product that sells and that is inherently more ecological because it's not going to produce more waste every year that you need to buy it. Is that culture happening? Is that shift happening?
I don't know if it's happening. I'd say you're absolutely right. There's kind of a conflict there. I think it depends on the company. It depends on, you know, the product. Absolutely. You see some companies that they design this right in. They design sort of, you know, things going. I think about all of my Apple products, you know, where I always need a new cable when I get a new one. And I mean, it's just, so sometimes, yes, I completely agree. Like, the infrastructure needs to change, and we need to better support that. You know, I would say it's all going to depend on the product, too, because you want things to last as long as you want them to last. Like, you know, so some things you don't want to last, you know, you want them to last, some things you do. So it all depends on, you know, what you're talking about. But I think you're absolutely right. We have a society where it's so many things are disposable, and that needs to change. And that's an infrastructure issue that hopefully somebody else can work on, too.
Hi again.
Hi.
really, really great, really interesting things, products that you have. I was actually more curious about the companies that you have and in regards to these products. So when you, for example, when you make the asphalt product or the hair product, do you do any lifetime analysis and do you follow these materials in nature?
You know, so where they go after?
Yes.
Yes. So, and some of them are going to. So there's like asphalt is really interesting because they, you know, we knew nothing about asphalt before this. And so now we have to, so depending on the industrial sector and whatever product area we're in, they jump in and they now go to asphalt conferences. They now learn, they do everything by industry standards. So they have to do all the testing, they do aging testing, and they have to do all of the, you know, things that industry has to do. So they essentially, you know, jump into whatever industrial sector that is, and they have to learn about it. As far as where things go for something like, I don't know that they've done that for like the hair dye, you know, like looking at where it go, you know, down the drain, into the water systems, you know, I don't know that they've done that. That's a good question. So that would be interesting to look at.
Yeah.
What happens after.
Definitely. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you for the lecture. That was great. My name is Wayne. I'm Director of Environmental Health and Safety for McGill. And I've built my career out of cleaning up the messes left by chemists. and my department continues to be responsible for collecting their hazardous waste, and we're really grateful for the job security that you bring us. I'd like to give you a test question. Can you tell me how much hazardous waste the Warner Babcock generates?
I cannot, but I could get you in touch with our EH&S person. And we actually are hiring a new person because ours is leaving, so we're looking for somebody. But he is fantastic because he could tell you right away what we are generating. And then we also are always looking for better ways of reducing our waste. So we bring in some really, like say analytical chemistry is one of the ones where you generate a lot of solvent waste. So we've been looking at ways of doing, you know, some different ways of separating using a lot less solvents. So we're always looking for ways, and he helps us with that. Our EH&S person kind of sits, and this is, if anybody wants to come to Boston and apply for this position, where it's out now, we've got, you know, we want our EH&S person to sit with research and compliance and regulations. We want them to kind of be in between so that they can help us on the innovation side and always look for better ways of, again, reducing our waste.
Keep trying to find ways. I'd like to retire one of these years.
I know. Wouldn't that be nice? But I think you are going to be in business for a while, so that's the reality of chemistry.
Hi, thanks so much for your talk. I'm not a chemist. I have a background in business and in finance. I was just wondering, in terms of commercialization of some of these really fascinating products, if there was any resistance from sort of like mainstream society or you know, just consumers to the idea that something that is effective can also be environmentally friendly, because I know up until recently, I also had this idea that if something is environmentally friendly, it's like not gonna work.
Right.
And exactly. How do you deal with it?
Yeah, exactly. We haven't come across that, but you're absolutely right. I mean, and I think I said this yesterday. I mean, I think that it was way back when these greener cleaners started coming out, and they didn't work very well. Like, you know, remember the first green cleaners that came out? And I feel like they gave us like a bad rap because you know, everyone always thought if it's environmentally friendly, it's just not going to work as well. I mean, and then the reality of it is those get pushed out of the market because we're not going to use them. So I feel like there's enough time has passed where, okay, now people aren't going to use those poor performers, so it's getting better. It's getting better, but we haven't come across that. And I think it also helps that John has a really strong reputation. You know, industry is always wanting to work with him because he has a really strong reputation for being innovative, and that's almost first as opposed to the green aspect. You know, they're more interested in the innovation, which is fine with us. You know, it's absolutely fine with us because just so happens to be greener. So, yeah.
I was just wondering how much of this research is actually open access and published in scientific journals, and how much of it is patented, and like how much other chemists can get involved with the
Good question. I would say when John went moved from academia into industry, it's mostly all patented, although some of the chemistry that we do is published and sort of out there. And I would say those are on the right side, the ones that are funded, more funded. Oh, no, that's not completely true. There are some, I would say a small percentage is not patented and it has been published. It's just kind of the nature of what we've done, you know, the investors' interests and, you know, that finance world of wanting to get the buyback. It is something that John is very interested in, though, some of these big challenges where lots of people could benefit from, and more than just one company, and that society would benefit from. So he's always looking for, and actually Babcock is open to other investors coming in to provide funds for those sort of the social impact investing and that sort of thing, that where you can open it up more. So it is, I would say most of it's patented. Yeah.
Hello. You went through a lot of projects today, so I guess could you determine from a business perspective which projects you would want to invest in going forward? So is it a type of matrix, or what are the criteria you would use to evaluate projects and which one you would want to invest into?
Good question. you know, a lot of the history, the challenge at Warner Babcock has been that we started in 2007, and then the economy went straight down, and Babcock lost a lot of his, our sole investor lost a lot of his funds. So we were in kind of survival mode for a little while, and that's why we went straight to whatever, we would work with companies, directly work with companies. So it was that contract invention. And that's why we did that for about 4 years until the economy started coming back up. And then he started to say to John, you know, what are some of your crazy ideas? And can we come make some of those come to fruition? And, you know, I don't think we've gotten to a lot of those other big ideas that he's got so for some of the big challenges. Because, there's a whole list of them, you know, a whole list of solutions that we still need. So I don't know how they would prioritize that. I mean, obviously it's got to be something that might have a good chance of success and be marketable and get out there and, you know, commercialized. So there's some calculations there. But geez, you name it, I'm sure he would love to be working on it.
Just to actually sort of touch upon what you just said, to what degree, with regards to biomimicry, do you feel that it is reactive in that, you know, marine biologist happens to touch a shark and says, oh, there's no algae on that?
Yeah.
But how much is it proactive? And to the extent that it is proactive, how can we get both, let's say, industry as well as academic institutions together communicating to really push forward exploration of potential opportunities?
Well, doing more of this, I guess. that's part of it. That's a good question. I would say, a lot of times, you know, people might come up with a great story after they've created a product. They might come up with, this was inspired by the shark. Where, you know, which came first, I don't know. I don't know. There's lots of different ways, I think, of doing that. Just getting out there and trying to work with outside of your industrial sector, or work outside of your, you know, the academia, reaching out to industry, which you guys are doing. So the more we can do that, the better. So I don't think I really answered your question. That was kind of a...
Well, actually, following up on this, I had a small question. Would you mind commenting a little bit about the structure of how you work as a team? How do you employ people? Who do you pick? Business people, chemistry, engineers? I mean, we have a bunch of students here who are, you know, looking at prospects of career here. And how do you make business and chemists work together?
That's a good question. So we have a mixture of PhDs, masters, bachelors. Everybody works side by side. I would say the majority of our people are scientists, but in the cases where we've created new companies, oftentimes we have, like, so for example, collaborative aggregates. the CTO of collaborative aggregates was a scientist at Warner Babcock, and he was given the opportunity to become the CTO of the new company. So it's a great opportunity for some of our employees at Warner Babcock to then go and lead some of these other companies. And he teamed up with a business guy to be the CEO. So we brought in a business guy, you know. So I think that's probably a good model for that. That one is, it's a combination, and that's what you guys are doing, I think, in this competition is saying, you know, it's got to be a combination, because oftentimes, you know, you have the science and the understanding of the science, but you need that business. So we have a combination, I would say. But we do have mostly scientists on the day-to-day, and we have about 35 scientists, and then five or so administrative and business support staff, and then again a few more business people brought into some of those other companies. So it's a combination.
Okay. Well, is there any question from the audience again? Well, if not, join me again in thanking Amy for a fantastic act. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was incredibly fascinating. So that brings a close to the public part of our workshop. Scattered amongst you are 30 graduate students from McGill, 10 MBA students, 10 from science, chemistry, and 10 from engineering. And what they'll be doing later on this afternoon is sitting through four more presentations on sustainable innovation. And then tomorrow they'll be put into interdisciplinary teams, some business people, some technical people on the same team, and presented with a challenge that has both business and technical angles to it. And we run it like a case competition. It's a very innovative format, and we generally get good reviews. So to the 30 of you who are participating in that, please report to room 620 at 3:30. And once again, thank you, Amy. That was absolutely fascinating. And I look forward to discussing more with you this afternoon.